art and reality play leapfrog with each other all through the Marvel and DC universe. A look at how superheroes smash into the US history timeline. Ahead on Science Goes to the Movies. Welcome to Science Goes to the Movies, a look at the stories of science and how they change our culture. I'm Faith Saley, and today we're going to talk about a couple of very interesting places where the fictional Marvel and DC universes intersected and sometimes changed the real U.S. history timeline. And to help us sort that out, we have Keith Dallas, Hofstra University English professor and editor-in-chief of the book series American Comic Book Chronicles, and Jonathan Rosenberg, Hunter College professor of history and author of How Far the Promised Land, World Affairs and the American Civil Rights Movement, and the forthcoming book, Dangerous Melodies and Diplomatic Instruments, When Classical Music Mattered in America. Thank you both for being here.
Great to be here.
Nice to be here.
My inner nerd is very, very excited about this conversation.
Your producer called me and said, you know, we need you on a show to talk about comic books. And I said, I have been waiting for this phone call for 40 years.
A star is born. And who knew it would be intersecting with science?
Right.
Gentlemen, let's start, of course, ladies first, with the newest Wonder Woman. In this 2017 adaptation of Charles Moulton and Harry G. Peters' 1941 creation, Diana, Princess of the Amazons, meets an American pilot who pulls her into the conflicts of World War I.
Who is this young woman?
She's my,
Diana, Princess of the Amazons.
Prince, Diana Prince. Believe that this war should stop. Help me stop it right now.
What are you?
You will soon find out.
Wonder Woman is a fantastic movie with fabulous messages about powerful women. And spoilers ahead, the plot of the movie revolves around the real-life armistice of November 1918. And one of the characters in the movies is Ares, the god of war. And again, big spoiler about to pop out of my mouth. In this Wonder Woman movie, the god of war is working towards peace as the architect of the armistice that ended World War I. Jonathan, what the heck? Was there something about the real armistice of World War I that would please a fictional god of war?
I think there was. The peace settlement, not so much the armistice, but the peace settlement, the Paris Peace Conference, was a very punitive peace. Woodrow Wilson, the American president, went over to France, and there he was, along with the leader of Britain and France, was going to negotiate the post-war world. Wilson himself, when he went over, wanted a magnanimous peace, a generous peace. It was, after all, the war to end all wars. Alas, that's not what happened. When he got there, the British Prime Minister, the French Premier, wanted to punish Germany, and that's what they did. They stripped Germany of some land, population, huge reparations payments, took Germany's colonies away, and finally held Germany responsible for the First World War. It was a very punishing peace. It was a peace that stoked great resentment in Germany. The god of war, I think, would have been heartened by this, because in fact, Hitler used the peace many years later to stoke the resentment and hostility of the German people.
So Keith, in DC Comics, did Wonder Woman fight in World War One?
No,
she didn't, did not. Right?
She made her comic book debut in October of 1941, late October 1941, so that puts it about 6 weeks before Japan bombs Pearl Harbor. And her earliest adventures establish her alter ego, Diana Prince, as a nurse in the U.S. Army during World War II. So, yeah, what we
Wonder Woman started out as a nurse.
Wonder Woman started out as a nurse.
Of course.
Yeah. It actually gets worse because she joins the Justice Society of America and they make her their secretary.
Wow.
And I'm sure she had to wear short skirts. So, Keith, how big were comic books by World War II?
They were tremendously big. We're talking tens of millions of copies sold a month.
I should be writing more comic books.
Well, you're in the wrong era.
Jonathan, historically, as World War II was raging, was it a given that America would join the fight against the Nazis?
Not at all. Not at all. Historically, America had always been very reluctant to get involved in European political affairs. There was a very strong isolationist sentiment in the country during the 1930s. The idea of World War I, as people look back on it, was seen to be a big mistake, that the United States had intervened in the war. Many people thought that. And the country really did not understand yet that what happened in Europe, what was going on in Europe, somehow was connected to American security, to American defense. Roosevelt was a very cautious and very savvy politician. He didn't want to get too far out in front of the American people. And even as the war began in September of 1939 in Europe, the American people still believed that they could sort of remain aloof. They would not get drawn into the war. Roosevelt was really rather clear in saying that he would not send Americans over to fight. And not until really, even on into 1941, the American people did not want to participate in the war. A very small percentage of the American people expressed an opinion suggesting that the country ought to be fighting.
What about the world of comic books? Did comic book superheroes start fighting Nazis before real life Americans?
Yeah, definitely. And that's John's response is very interesting, because if you look at comic books in 1940, early 1941, there are many comic books where the superheroes are fighting, if not flat out Nazis, thinly disguised Nazis. And one of the most famous comic book covers is Captain America Comics number 1, which arrived in newsstands in December of 1940. So now we're talking a full year before Japan bombed Pearl Harbor. And on this cover is Captain America, a symbol of America, the representation of the United States. He is punching Hitler in the mouth.
Wow.
And he's not anomalous. I mean, I can tell you in April of 1941, that's eight months before Pearl Harbor. Mm-hmm. And this company published a comic book with the title of Daredevil Battles Hitler. And it's 54 pages of a superhero dismantling Hitler's war machine around the globe. So your response is interesting.
And I'm curious, we think of comic books for kids, sort of. At that time, 10 million comic books being sold a month, were they mostly read by children?
Or? Yeah, yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Wow, that's a huge impact on youth sending those messages.
Yes.
And so that leads to a question for both of you. Do you think comic books and superheroes played a role in pushing America to see the evil in the Nazis?
Well, I'm interested in your response. I mean, I would say my assumption was that the comic books were, I don't know if it's fair to say pushing this perspective, but reaffirming the perspective that the comic book creators, so Captain America Comics, a full year before Pearl Harbor, those creators, that's Captain America created by Joe Simon and Jack Kirby, they're at least recognizing maybe the inevitability of America entering the war, and they're giving their superhero sort of a head start on the hostilities.
It may be that those people who were writing the comic books actually thought that the United States had to be a little more assertive, a little more mm-hmm. determined to fight, and perhaps they were sort of, as you suggest, kind of giving a hint to American policymakers
right.
that this was something that needed to be done.
A hint? I mean, on the cover, punching
yeah.
Hitler in the mouth.
Well, and the creators, years later, the creators said they were receiving death threats from Nazi sympathizers publishing that comic book.
Who were the comic book writers? Who were the people who were creating
these stories? I mean, mostly we're talking about, working class men, many of them Jewish. So
So they're probably their grandparents had come from maybe Europe, maybe Eastern Europe or
many
something?
Many of them immigrated themselves, you know.
And now that's interesting, you know? Isn't it? Because those people might have been inclined and supported American intervention in the war when the country itself was not yet ready to intervene in the war.
I mean, nowadays we'd call them woke, right? They were woke. Yeah, and they're trying to maybe show kids what was going on.
But and I do feel the need to stress, again, in 1940, early 1941, that this was a trend in particularly superhero comics, presenting, again, either Hitler directly or thinly disguised Nazis as the villain of the comic book.
Right, because how are you ever going to get a better, i.e. worse villain than that? Right. Yeah. So, by the way, just for fun, we Googled superheroes punching Nazis and found tons.
Yeah, I bet.
Yeah, from Captain America to the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles. But our favorite was this one, where supervillain Red Skull tells the Joker that he would make an excellent Nazi, and the Joker replies, "I may be a criminal lunatic, but I'm an American criminal lunatic." Did you know about this, that the Joker had boundaries?
Yeah, I mean, what's interesting about this is a story that takes place in World War II. It's two villains from competing comic book companies. You know, the Joker is Batman's villain, that's DC Comics. The Red Skull is Captain America's villain, that's Marvel Comics. And it's rare to see that type of intercompany crossover. And
I mean, hatred of Nazis brings people together.
I guess so.
That's true. They were an easy people to hate, frankly.
Yeah.
There were some supporters in the United States, but by and large, these people were not beloved. And I think it does, you know, you see this manifestation of this. They were an easy target to focus on.
Now, the Joker may have been surprisingly patriotic, but Marvel has not pulled its punches when addressing real evils in American history. Captain America, played by Chris Evans in the modern movies, first appeared in 1941, which actually predates Marvel Comics. In Timely Comics, the character was a patriotic super soldier who fought the Axis powers of World War II. But in 2003, we learned the darker side of how Steve Rogers became Captain America when Marvel Comics released a miniseries written by the late Robert Morales called Truth, Red, White, and Black. Keith, this is a fascinating story. Who was Isaiah Bradley, and what happened in that Marvel comic?
All right, so the premise behind Truth, Red, White, and Black is that Isaiah Bradley was part of an African-American battalion that was used essentially as guinea pigs to perfect the super soldier serum that eventually gets administered to Steve Rogers, who becomes Captain America, the Captain America that we know. Tragically, Isaiah Bradley ends up, because of it, the super soldier serum, he ends up with some pretty severe brain damage. But interestingly enough, his grandson, Elijah Bradley, becomes his own superhero. He becomes the Patriot and a founding member of a new superhero group called the Young Avengers. So the legacy is carried on.
Yeah. Jonathan, how does the real history of the Tuskegee syphilis tests intersect with the Captain America backstory?
Yeah, this is a very, very grim and unpleasant story. In 1932, something called the U.S. Public Health Service decides that they're going to investigate the impact of syphilis on human beings. And they go down to Alabama, I think it's Macon County, Alabama, and they recruit, I think it's 600 African American men to conduct these tests to see what syphilis does to humankind.
Recruit.
They recruit them. They offer them, I think, free meals, free medical care, free burial insurance, and they get hundreds of volunteers. Two-thirds of them, I think it was 401 of them, actually had syphilis. The rest, about 200, did not have syphilis. They were sort of the control group. So what they do is they monitor these men over time. This begins in 1932. The story grows particularly horrifying when in 1947, penicillin is developed such that it can be used to treat syphilis successfully. These men, these 400 men who had syphilis and who were being monitored, were not given penicillin, because that would, in some sense, mess up what the experiment was trying to accomplish. So for years, from that point on and for years afterward, these men who had been diagnosed with syphilis, they didn't know they had syphilis, by the way, and weren't told that they had syphilis, were not given the effective treatment that then existed. Large numbers of them died, large numbers either of syphilis or complications from syphilis. They passed it on to their wives. Some of their children were born with syphilis. It wasn't this investigation, this experiment, went from 1932 to 1972, 40 years until it was uncovered, revealed what was going on, and then obviously it was stopped. It really is a kind of horrifying example of medical, quote-unquote, science gone bad, but also, I think, a horrible example of some of the things that happen in the realm of American race relations. These were all African-American men in the Jim Crow South who volunteered for this horrifying experiment.
It's a terrible, devastating story.
Yeah. Terrible story.
And I think generations, starting with mine, and I'm in my 40s, don't even know much about it. Yeah. And it's, and, you know, we're sitting here talking about how simple and clear it is to vilify Nazis, and this happened on our soil. Do you think, Keith, that the red, white, and black story was very much influenced?
I know. I mean, okay. they've come out and flat out said that the Tuskegee experiment is a direct influence on that series. Yeah.
Okay, let's talk Superman. In a 1946 radio serial called Clan of the Fiery Cross, all heck breaks loose in Metropolis when Jimmy Olsen replaces softball team pitcher Chuck Riggs, an American of British descent, with Tommy Lee, an American of Chinese descent. Turns out little Chucky Riggs has an uncle who's the Grand Scorpion of a fictional stand-in for the Ku Klux Klan. Let's break down why shows like this are important. And now, before we go any further, I need to warn viewers that we're going to look at some very distressing images. Jonathan, what do we know about the Ku Klux Klan's interactions with children?
What we can say in speaking more broadly about lynching in the South, which was something that kind of emerges in the late 19th century, the lynching of black Americans by white Southerners.
Is that what lynching means in that context? White Southerners hang black people?
Well, okay. First of all, lynching took place, it occurred throughout the country, but it occurred primarily in the South. Most of the lynchings were white people killing, murdering black people. There were some lynchings which were white on white lynchings, but the vast majority were white on black violent crimes. And what we see, there is a photographic record. Now, as I said, it emerges in the late 19th century. It continues throughout much of the 20th century, lynchings. Thousands of people were lynched. Thousands of black people were lynched. What we see from the photographic record with respect to children is that white children were brought by their parents to witness these horrific episodes. We have photographic evidence of this. So not only can't we get our mind around the notion of lynching itself as a horrifying crime, but worse than that, there are white parents, white Southerners, who are bringing their children to see this happen. Presumably, they think there's something worthwhile in some horrifying sense for them to watch. There are recorded newspaper accounts of women nursing infants while watching lynchings.
In 1946, Keith, how popular was Superman for kids?
Well, I think if we go by the fact, so 1946, so Superman is starring in several comic books, not just one. As you mentioned, he has his own radio show. He has a daily newspaper comic strip. He's also, by this point, a licensed character on merchandise, on things like clothing and Kellogg's cereals. And generally, you know, merchandisers don't like the licensed characters that are unpopular. So I think just that alone, I think, can prove the immense popularity of the character.
Again, the primary audience at that time was kids.
Yeah.
To foment those kind of conversations,
right,
ideally in American homes,
right,
is so powerful.
Yes.
I mean, what do you think? Is it hugely important for a fictional character to take a stand against evil?
And one of the defining aspects of a superhero is his or her nobility, then he or she has to take a stand.
As a historian, Jonathan, what do you make of this?
I certainly think it's worthy to, if children are imbibing this kind of stuff, they're reading comics and so forth, I think it's absolutely worthwhile for them to get this sense of the nobility of the people they're going to admire. And if the people they're going to admire are striking out against evil, that's a good thing. I'm all for it. How it shapes a society, it's tougher to measure mm-hmm. that, but it's certainly worthwhile. That's the kind of thing you would want your kids exposed to, certainly.
All right, now let's talk about superheroes and the Cold War. In the early 1960s, a guy named Stan Lee worked for his uncle, Marvel publisher Martin Goodman. In 1961, Stan Lee and Jack Kirby released the Fantastic Four number one, featuring four cranky, argumentative, very human superheroes. And no one had ever seen anything like it. It was an overnight success. These more human superhumans needed real-life villains. Again and again, Marvel found its villains in the USSR. Keith, what would you say that the Cold War kind of revived Marvel?
Honestly, I'm going to go back to the two creators you mentioned, Stan Lee and Jack Kirby. I think we got to give them credit for reviving Marvel. Let's throw in Steve Ditko, co-created Spider-Man and Doctor Strange, so he deserves credit. You know, I see your point about the Cold War. I think, though, I would lean more towards the storytelling techniques that Stan Lee and Jack Kirby created for that era of comics.
Jonathan, in World War II, weren't the Soviets just our friends? Like, just recently our friends? I mean, what happened to Uncle Joe Stalin on the cover of Life magazine?
The Soviets were our allies during World War II. We had to defeat Hitler, and the United States and the Soviet Union formed an alliance. And in fact, throughout the war, Stalin and the Russian people were portrayed in very noble, heroic terms. They tried to humanize Stalin. Magazine stories, in one magazine story, I think it was Look magazine, Stalin was described as a very flashy dresser who made Winston Churchill appear positively shabby by comparison. This was Joseph Stalin, one of the great mass murderers of the 20th
wow.
century. He was described as a man who liked to read American literature. He became known in some circles as Uncle Joe. The Russian people, too, were portrayed very heroically in movies, some of which were subsidized by the American government. The U.S. government was trying to fortify the alliance between the United States and the Soviet Union. And in fact, the perception of the American people was really quite positive of the Soviet Union during the war, which obviously helped with the war effort.
It's so astonishing and obvious, I guess, about how much pop culture and media presentation
yes.
matters and changes history.
Yes.
And I didn't know that. I didn't know that
Russia
was...
You didn't know that about Uncle Joe?
No, I mean, not until we did research for the show.
Right.
I didn't know that we were pals as a culture in our heads
right.
with Russia.
Now, here's something interesting coming back to Superman history. So you mentioned Look magazine.
Mm-hmm.
Do you have a year for that?
I don't.
Okay. Because
was it around World War II?
No, it was definitely during
right.
World War II.
Right,
absolutely.
Because I can show you, again, Look magazine.
Mm-hmm.
There was a comic strip in the magazine by the Superman creators, where Superman abducts Stalin and Hitler, brings them to essentially this world court, so they stand trial for their crimes against humanity. Obviously, this is before we align ourselves
yes.
with Russia,
right.
but.
From your point of view, I know you don't have a background of being a comic book reader, but from your point of view as a historian,
mm-hmm.
Do you think Cold War Russian Stalin, Russian villains are just as good / evil as a Hitler? I mean, is this all fecund area?
I would imagine so. I haven't read deeply in the comic book literature, but the analogy between Hitler and Stalin, between the Nazis and the Soviets, certainly in American culture becomes quite close and tight. And the Soviets clearly become our great adversary for 40 years and with all sorts of consequences, most of them quite bad.
Jonathan, it took us so long to get into World War II. Did all of this fear of Soviets drive us straight into the Korean Wars?
It's certainly the fear of the Soviet Union, the fear of the spread of communism certainly drove us to to enter the Korean War. In June of 1950, the North Koreans invade South Korea in an attempt to unify the Korean Peninsula. Harry Truman is in Independence, Missouri, his home at the time. He's the president. He hears about this, and he's flying back to Washington the next day. And he's thinking, so he says in his memoirs, he's thinking, what should we do? What should I do as the president? And he thinks we must respond to this North Korean invasion of the South, because if we don't, it will be like when the democracies did not respond to the dictators in the 1930s and plunge the world into war. So now Truman imagines the U.S. has to respond very, very aggressively and assertively, and the United States indeed fights in Korea.
Truman's kind of acting like a superhero. He
feels
the
sense.
Weight of the world on him,
yes,
right?
Yes, he does.
The analogies are fascinating because in the world of superheroes, they're always ready to get involved.
Right. That's
what it is to be a superhero. You must get involved, even if your alter ego is like, really?
Yeah,
you know?
Right.
I think I've said wow in this episode more than I've ever said it on any show. It's so interesting how much pop culture can influence society and how powerfully it can reflect it.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Thank you both for bringing your points of view to the discussion.
You're very welcome.
Unfortunately, that's all we have time for. For all of you watching, be sure to check out our Science Goes to the Movies Facebook page for web-only clips and keep up with everything related to Science Goes to the Movies all in one place. And if you want to watch past episodes or download our new podcast, check us out at cuny.tv.